We have a quorum. Mr. Raymond Wong, can we get started, please? What do you mean? Okay, I think we have a quorum now. And it's time, thank you. Actually, we have just made the quorum. Now we could invite the secretary and the witnesses into the conference room. Thank you. Welcome, Secretary and your team. I don't propose to introduce your team one by one, okay? Any declaration of interest, please? Kenneth? Mr. Chairman, I was a Housing Authority member who has just stepped down. Mr. Mnung Singh, I was a former Housing Authority member. Any other declarations, please? No? We could start now the hearing on Chapter 3 of the Audit Report Number 61. At the last hearing, at the last meeting, there's a point that the director would like to clarify.
I believe members will have seen in the press coverage the suggestion first raised at the PAC hearing on Monday, that consideration should be given to deduct marks from students who apply under the quota and point system, the QPS system, as a disincentive to discourage students from applying for PRH through this channel. There have been some suggestion this would be unfair to students. Now, both the long-term housing strategy and the Director of Audit have recommended that the Housing Authority review the operations of the QPS specifically to screen out ineligible QPS applicants from the waiting list on a periodic basis. Accordingly, I will be following up on this issue with the Housing Authority. Now, members will recall there was a discussion on the fact that there have been a large number of young people applying for PRH through the QPS in recent years. In that context, there was a comment from one of the members that students would be most unlikely to get an offer for housing quickly, and even when they do, they're likely to be ineligible. The suggestion was made that we take into account applicants' circumstances when reviewing the QPS system in future. I indicated that we already deduct 30 points from applicants who are living in public rental housing. I went on to accept that we could consider extending this approach to deduct marks from students to give a clear message that public rental housing is for the most disadvantaged in the community. But I must stress that this is just one of many suggestions we have received on ways to rationalize the QPS list. Others include, of course, the possibility of setting a higher age limit for applicants, and as members will recall, I did not agree with that approach either. As the media coverage over the last couple of days has clearly shown, this really is a very difficult and sensitive issue. And as one of the members remarked, we must be aware of the interest of all parties and be compassionate when we administer the public housing program. At the same time, we do need to have clear and rational systems for allocating our precious public housing resources. So we will study the practicability of all suggestions to enhance the QPS before we make specific recommendations for the Housing Authority members to consider. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Prescott. Thank you, Secretary for Transport. I think for value for money audit, that in public hearing, members ask questions doesn't necessarily reflect the findings
exactly.
of the committee, I think. So
exactly.
Please be ensured that this has always been the stand of the committee.
Yeah.
The committee will make a report, and that report, having considered all the facts that have been obtained from the documents, from the public hearings, and from the answers given to us in relation to the question being asked, so on that basis has always been the tradition and the procedure that have been adopted in the public hearings and in our findings.
Yeah.
So the recommendations will be made by the committee after all the public hearings and after consideration of all facts and different and on what available documents. So what our members ask question, which is outside the ambit of the report, they are free to ask.
Sure.
But that somehow must be related to value for money audit. So I just want to make that also very clear.
Sure.
Hi, Yong Wan.
Mr. Raymond Wong, that statement, can we be given a copy of that statement, please?
Okay,
thank you. Kenneth, you're the first to go. Mr. Members, we are now on part three of the report. Mr. Chairman, for part three and part four, that is part four, tackling abuse of public rental housing, can we consider the two parts together because they're related? In that case, members, we could ask questions on both parts three and four. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Part three, there are three main areas, vacant units, well-off tenants policy, and under-occupation policy. First, let me start with well-off tenants policy. At the last hearing, members have received a paper, PAC 31/13-14. That's actually a document provided by the department. At Appendix 3 to the paper, there's some introduction on the well-off tenants policies. Now, when we consider the value for money study, and before we decide on our position, I would like to first hear from the department about the well-off tenants policy. Some of the policies were in place since 1987, and in your paper you said that it's only for those public rental housing tenants whose financial position is improved, then for them you may reduce housing subsidy to them. So your policy objective is to reduce housing subsidy. But then my interpretation of the well-off tenancy tenants policy, Mr. Chairman, is that we could increase the availability of PRH units. In other words, we make the well-off tenants vacate the units. So these are the two objectives. Which go first? Which is the primary objective, please? Thank you. Secretary, in the 1990s, under the policy on safeguarding rational allocation of public housing resources, is as Dr. Leung put it, for households with income exceeding the limit, then we reduce housing subsidy on the basis of the multiples of the income limit. And so they may have to pay a high rent, but still that would be below the market rent. If they are unwilling to be subjected to asset means test, or if their income has reached a certain level and it's believed that they should be able to afford private housing, then they will be asked to leave the public housing net. So that's also to help increase the availability of PRX units. So both are the objectives of that particular policy. Dr. Leung, department, can you tell us whether you have a dedicated team on investigation involving well-off tenants, or do you have a relatively large unit? Perhaps I'll defer the actual operation to my colleagues in the department. Ms. Liu, on the enforcement of the well-off tenant policies. First, the tenants have been in public rental housing for more than 10 years, and every 2 years, a declaration of income must be made. And we have over 1,000 officers in our 160 estates to deal with such cases. On average, every year, there are about 180,000 to 189,000 households who have to declare their income. They will submit the declaration forms to the SA officers, and the 1,000 odd frontline SA officers will be the first stage of vetting. Now, most of the cases after vetting will still pay the original rent, and so for those cases, they would have been dealt with at the SA office level. For special cases, we have a central audit unit to do spot check. And so we have a central team, about 120 colleagues at the headquarters level. Of course, they not just dealing with well-off tenants audit, they also dealing with abuse of public housing resources cases. So they might do random check, or some suspect cases might be referred by the estate office to the central team, or there may be complaints, and then the central team will do a more in-depth investigation. 180,000 to about 190,000. There are about 720,000 households now. For those who have stayed in public rental housing for more than 10 years and who need to declare income, there are about 380,000, 390,000 households. So every year, that means our investigation is on about 180 to 190,000 cases. So you're saying that the estate officers are responsible for implementing the well-off tenant policy. They have other tasks as well. This is not their only task. Is that correct? Yes. For the declaration forms submitted, they only form a small part of the work of the estate officers. The estate officers, of course, responsible for the management of the entire estate. They have to look after maintenance, cleaning, and other matters. Kenneth? Annex C. There is another Appendix A to Annex C. This is a table, actually. From 2008 to 2013 to 14, this table shows how many households are required to declare income and how many households have to pay double rent or 1.5 times rent, and so on. Mr. Liu said that there are over 300,000 households who have to declare declaration, but how come in 2013 to 14 we only see the figure 200,000? It's for that particular year, because 400,000 units spread over 2 years, so because they only declare once every 2 years. So that means in 1 year we deal with about 200,000 cases, but then there are actually 400,000 households who are required to declare income. Now, I don't think it's a bad thing for estates to have well-off tenants, because that shows the public housing policy is successful. It's because tenants who move to PRH will be able to improve their standards of living, so it's a good thing. Now, you say the number of households declaring income is 200,000 a year, so over 2 years, that means 400,000, but only 21,500 households have to pay 1.5 times of rent, and only 3,200 households have to pay double rent. Does it mean that, so my first question is, would you actually check every declaration form in great detail? And if you ask them to declare every 2 years, wouldn't that be a bit of a nuisance? Maybe these days it will take longer, so like longer than 10 years for someone to become a well-off tenant. So would you consider changing the cycle to 12 years? Well, please look at it from the angle of value for money audit. I'm coming to that. Well, it's your time. I just don't want you to waste your time. Oh, so in terms of using resources, let's take the starting point of 12 years. So they don't have to fill in forms in less than 10 years. So what is your response, please? Director, our secretary, look at it from the point of view of value for money audit, please. Now, in the 1990s, when the line was drawn at 10 years, we did take into account what Dr. Kenneth Leung said. That is for PRX tenants, they would have gone through income vetting, so that means they were not well-off tenants when they moved into public rental housing. After 10 years, maybe their financial position improved. That's why we set it at 10 years, not 3 years. But whether 10 years is the most reasonable, that's a matter of judgment, of course. There have been various views in the community. Some say we should do away with the well-off tenants policies altogether. Some say we're being too relaxed. And some ask why shouldn't it be 5 years, 7 years, and so on. So there are various views in the community on this point. Now, every year, it's just about 24,000 households. And you have over 100 people dealing with the cases, you know, and their staff costs, obviously. So can you explain it from the point of view of value for money? Now, from the point of value for money, our concern is that there are people who should have been caught in this policy net, but we haven't found them out. But in terms of the income and asset vetting, that's detailed work. Mr. Liu could supplement in a moment. Well, out of 170,000 households, only less than 30,000 have to pay 1.5 times or double rent. But that's the objective fact. That's the financial position of the tenants. So we cannot then come to any value for money conclusion on that basis, because that's their actual financial position. Mr. Liu, well, I would like to thank members for your concern about our workload. Now, after tenants have moved in for 10 years, they will have to declare income every 2 years. It's on honor system. If for any household, they complete a form, of course, they must provide income proof. But if their income is some distance from the level where they may be asked to pay double rent, well, there's declaration form. Then in the declaration form, they just need to fill in their occupation and they provide employment proof. And let's say it's a two-person family, for the income limit is 26,000, but then their income is only $16,000. That means they are a long way from paying double rent. Then they will close our file on this particular case after the case manager has studied it, because we do agree if we spend so much time on dealing with declaration forms, well, then on the part of the residents, they feel that they have to complete a lot of forms, and on the part of our staff, there's a huge workload. That's why we try to strike a balance this way. Thank you.
I understand that according to Appendix A, if one is to vacate the PRH unit, it's after they have started paying a double rent, and once every 2 years, they will have to go through the income and asset vetting. And if they choose not to go through the vetting system, they will be asked to vacate the PRH unit. Is that right? Secretary. If that asset has exceeded, asset or income has exceeded the limit, currently is that as 84 times of the income limit, well, they will have to choose not to declare before they are asked to vacate. Well, the information is in Appendix A, but if you turn the page to Appendix B, it says that from 2008 to 2013, over the 8-year period, how many households have surrendered the PRH unit? From the figure, we see that you have used a lot of manpower and resources to monitor these well-off tenants, and you can only recover 261 units to 536 units. The 261 unit is the figure in 2012 and 2013. So you have spent quite a lot of manpower and resources to recover so few flats. Do you think that it is worth the resources and manpower, Secretary? I think we should not just rely on the figures. The policy objective is to ensure that those who are in need will receive assistance in the form of PRH units. So when it comes to regular income and asset vetting, that is the reason. The number is small. Maybe it's simply because there are just not many households that have fallen outside the level. And as long as they are within the limit, we will keep monitoring the situation. If you look at the track record that there aren't so many well-off tenants, then you have to review whether there is a need to have a decoration once every 10 years. Over the many years, you see that there are only a handful of well-off tenants, so you should not have spent so much resources and manpower to find something that is few in number. You have 1,000 staff members and over 100 in the central team. You have to think about whether it is worth your effort, and if it is to be done, whether there are better alternatives. Director.
I think it's important to understand our resources are not just entirely devoted to this one task. As you heard, the state staff are involved. We have a central team which does more than just this exercise. So the resources that are devoted to this are reasonable, given all of the things that we have to do. But the more important thing to remember is people are aware that we do check. We will take action to remove people whose income or assets exceed the limits that we set. And therefore, it is an important control mechanism for us to ensure that the resources, housing resources, that are very short supply, are only used by those people who are genuinely entitled. So I think it is actually value for money if you see it in the context of that perspective.
Kenneth,
that's really where we're coming from.
Kenneth, a follow-up. Please refer to 3.4. It is a good thing to encourage people to make good use of the limited resources. One of the recommendations of the audit is at 3.40C, explore ways to encourage well-off PRH tenants to purchase HOS flats. Are there any measures being planned to pursue this? That is, say, for example, they will be given priorities in the purchase of HOS flats, Secretary. In the past, when there was a regular production of HOS flats, there are some PRH tenants, especially those who are well-off tenants, would choose to purchase HOS flats. They will use a green form and they will be given priority. And in the new HOS, there is a quota for green formers. The recommendation of the audit, if we adopt the past practice, well, as PRH tenants, they can use the green form. And as to whether there will be additional measures to give more priority to well-off tenants, well, we will explore that. Thank you. The second one is Raymond Wong, but I would like to follow up on what Mr. Leung asked. Secretary, can you give us some information? In the past 2 years, how much money did you spend on monitoring the financial situation of well-off tenants? And how much rent did you get out of the 20,000 units in the past 2 years? I am not negating your policy, but we look at it from the perspective of value for money, whether there are better alternatives. If we use the basis of resources to see what the outcome is, we can gauge whether it is effective. I don't want you to spend too much time. Just use the past 2 years to give us the picture. The second point. Mr. Leung asked a very good question. Please refer to 3.40C. You said you would consider it. But you also said that under the current policy, when well-off tenants have vacated the PRH unit, then prospective tenants will move in. Every year there may be 200 or 400 units. To a certain extent, it addressed the housing needs of those in need. They don't have to live in SDUs, subdivided flats, or have to pay expensive rent. And the current policy is to, well, we'll reduce the number of people buying HOS flats because you open the market for non-PRH tenants. Because you don't need a green form to buy those flats. There are several thousand units. Is it 2,000? Well, I think, Chairman, you're talking about the secondary market for of HOS flats. That premiums does not have to be paid. Green formers, including PRH tenants, can purchase existing HOS flats in the secondary market without paying premium. Our preliminary plan is that apart from the red formers, there are 5,000 quotas in two phases, each 2,500, and they are Y formers, then they can purchase HOS flats. This is to boost the turnover. Well, whenever there is a new batch of HOS flats, green formers can purchase them. In the past, the ratio is 60 to 40. 60% of the flats will be for green formers. White formers, that is non-PRH tenants, are also eligible for the purchase of HOS flats. That's why we adopt a ratio. But the thing is that well-off PRH tenants should move to HOS flats. But your current measure of the secondary market is to allow non-PRH tenants to apply. As a result, the queue will be longer. We have to look at how to best use resources from the point of value for money. I've said this many times before. Whether it is HOS or PRH units, they are for those in need and not those who want to buy a flat. Well, if they can move to HOS flats, it's a good thing because those who are in need will be able to move into PRH units. Next, Mr. Raymond Wong. I think, and this is a Gordian knot, because well, in the last government, HOS flats was put to a halt. And now, no matter what you do, you're actually flogging a dead horse. In the entire operation, where there are inadequacies, there should be an improvement to rationalize the use of public resources. For those in need, they will be given PRH units. Well, to put it bluntly, whether we have this public hearing is meaningless. Just follow the policies. We are here just to do some patchwork. I speak based on what I've read from the audit report, and I've learned things. Well, as legislators, we are actually useless. So it's not the government, not the administration that is useless. We are useless too. We have too little information. If we look at from the perspective of equity, we will not be able to get any answers. Please ask your question. We talk about parts 3 and 4. For part 3 is the maximizing the rational utilization of public rental housing flats. First, I would like to talk about paragraph 3.5, that is, the management and control of unoccupied flats. Well, you have to answer me, otherwise I will chase you for answers. Paragraph 3.5. As at 31st of March 2013, there are altogether 12,471 unoccupied flats is 1.7%. Of course, we would like to keep this as low as possible because we're talking about an average cost, excluding land cost, of $700,000 for one single unit. So one unoccupied flat is a waste. An additional day is a waste because we're talking about money here. And under Table 16, unoccupied flats, 1.7%. which is a lot higher than the figure announced by the Housing Authority, 0.6%. When you calculate unoccupied flats, the unlettable flats, that is 4,370, and under offer flats, 3,964, well, they are not occupied, but you exclude them in the calculation of unoccupied flats. In response to the audit's inquiries, the Housing Department said that the unoccupied flats shows the extent of utilization of PRH units. So for unlettable flats and under offer flats, we're talking about 8,507. Why doesn't the Housing Authority include this figure? I don't accept the HD's explanation. Let's look at Table 19. Out of the 4,370 unoccupied flats, 598 of them are not allocated for some other reasons, and there are also some that are not allocated for being converted or being reserved and other reasons. Well, for these converted flats, they are in a way unutilized public rental housing. If you take those figures and you include the figures, then you will reflect better the actual situation, and from the figures we will be able to see the efficiency of conversion. That is, you have to include these figures into unoccupied flats, otherwise you will not be able to paint us the true picture. Secretary, first, I fully agree that PRH units are precious resources. We don't want them unoccupied or unoccupied for a long time. But we want to reflect the true situation. That's why we have to include the figure for those that are unlettable. I will defer to Mr. Liu as to why some of them will have to be excluded. Mr. Liu, about the 815 units, you will find supplementary information in paragraph 3.19. Out of the 815 flats, 672 of them were included, were frozen from letting due to redevelopment or conversion. In Tai O Tin Mei House, there are 86 units. We have converted the entire block into HOS flats for sale, and 140 flats for various reasons, say for example management reasons, they are not let. From the document you will see that 35 flats, the reason cannot be found. And I have explained in the last session, at the time when the audit came to conduct the investigation, we could not find the 35 files. Later, they were found. And they are for various reasons, say for example, waterproofing works, rooftop seepage, and that's why they are not let. And there are certain flats we have loaned to the law enforcement agencies for surveillance purpose. There is a general manager responsible for allocation. He is responsible for overseeing all the unoccupied flats. If it's unoccupied for more than 2 months, the regional general manager, if the flat is reserved for more than 2 months, an approval will have to be given from the regional general manager. And all these reservations will be overseen by the general manager of allocation. Well, this is a technical reason, and I'm talking about principle and policy, so I don't need an answer from Mr. Liu. We're talking about under offer flats and unlettable flats. Altogether, there are over 8,000 of such units. I'm only talking about the grand total, over 8,000. They are unoccupied and not allocated. I'm talking about the policy, not a technical, not technicality. And in table 16, about 3,964 under offer flats. There is a no average vacant period supplied by the housing department. In the end, how many of them are occupied? The offer was taken. Under table 16, 3,964 under offer flats. The housing department did not give us the average vacancy period, and I want that. Mrs. Ho would like to supplement. Mrs. Ho? Thank you. Thank you for your question. First of all, let me explain the unlettable flats, 4,370 in the table. The distribution, about 3,750 of them are unlettable because over 60% of them are reserved for conversion into elderly housing. We're talking about over 2,000. We're talking about 2,674, and another 135 units are quarters used by our estate officers. And about 689 of them are frozen for redevelopment purpose. 252 of them are reserved by the URA also for redevelopment purpose. And they have paid us a fee for the reservation. We're talking about 3,750 and another 620 of them, as Mr. Liu said, they are used for operation purpose and other purpose. Of the 3,964 under offer flats, I can tell you that so far, close to 90% of them are let. We're talking about 3,400 flats. The remaining, some of them are put into the express flat allocation scheme. Over 150 of them are under let. And another 83 units of them are flat, and 28 of them become unlettable flats, and they will be pulled under the express flat allocation scheme. So for the unoffered flats, they have got a purpose. So we can't include them under lettable vacant flats. This is a very detailed information because we did not have the information earlier. Still, we have to look at it from a value for money perspective. Let's not talk about the unlettable flats because they have got other purposes. And 90% of the under-offer flats have been taken up. I'm talking about the vacancy period. We're talking about rational utilization. So you have to tell me, prior to that, how long have they been left and vacant before you can make use of the 3,900 units? We need to know, because we want to know whether the situation will improve later. Ms. So, Mrs. Ho, can you supply the information in written form later? And can you now give us an answer? Secretary, you would like to answer?
Mrs. Ho was talking about the 4,370 unlettable flats, and we can provide a written reply regarding the breakdown of these flats. About vacancy periods, of course, we can also provide this information. It's due to special reasons. Yes, please also state the special reasons, because we will then be able to know in detail the overall picture of utilization or allocation of flats. And we're more concerned, as you know, about the waiting time. So if you can allocate flats rationally, then those in front of the queue can be allocated with flats earlier. Now let's talk about 3.7 to 3.9 on vacant flats. Now, in the middle of 2013, the audit inspected 3 housing estates. 43 under-offer flats have been vacant for more than 3 months, with 14 more than a year. Audit further examined the distribution of under-offer flats in all estates and noted that as at the 31st of March 2013, 9 estates each had more than 50 under-offer flats. So I'd like the housing department to explain this about the 43 under-offer flats that have been vacant for more than 3 months with 14 more than a year. I'd like to know the reasons. Mrs. Ho? Thank you, Chairman. Sorry, my eyesight is not very good. Thank you, Chairman. I'll try to take this question. For some flats, they will go under the express flat allocation scheme if they're left vacant for too long. In some cases, after we have compiled the list, if the potential tenant of some of the flats dislike the flats, these vacated flats cannot be put under the express flat allocation scheme. And during this period, the flats will not go under the list of lettable flats. Now, under the EFAS pooling exercise, the figures pulled, the flats pools were respectively 2,400, 2,200, and 2,500 flats. What about further breakdown? Now, the flats allocated under EFAS, many flats have been allocated. For this year, the target is some 2,000, and so far 1,000 odd have been allocated. At this stage, we are allocating family-based flats, and at the next stage, we are going to allocate flats for singletons. So it's very likely that that flats can be allocated. Secretary, please give us some figures. Yes, 3.10. The Housing Department reported that 4,137 vacant flats available for letting as at 31st March 2013, and Table 16 in Para 3.4. All right, for the 887 flats that have been vacant for 1 year or more, about 53% or 470 flats had not been included in previous CFAS exercises. What's the reason for that, Mrs. Ho? Thank you, Chairman. Now, some of the flats are in Longtin Estate in Tai O. After its completion, because of the remote location, no applicant is interested in the estate, and we therefore reserve the estate for HOS allocation, and therefore it doesn't come under EFAS. Because of the remote allocation, it will be converted to HOS, right. Chairman, actually I'm trying to make up for the missing information. Now, according to the Housing Department, for refurbishment works for vacant flats, it's no more than 44 days. However, in Table 18, we can see that Flat 3, C1P flats, works order, between the works order and the refurbishment completion date is as long as 2 months. We understand that for these flats there might be serious water seepage problems or some structural problems or structural upgrading, etc. More time would be needed for refurbishment works. However, we also agreed that the Housing Department should closely monitor the refurbishment period and try to compress the time frame. So my question to the Housing Department is whether you will set up a monitoring unit to stringently monitor the refurbishment period. because it actually has taken over 44 days. That's the case for many flats. Perhaps I'll defer to Mr. Liu to let members know the our existing monitoring work. We're talking about flat 3. So please answer the question on flat 3 before you go on to talk about your general policy. It's Cho Ping North Estate. It is a TPS estate for flat 3. Now, the vacant date was in February 2012, but works didn't start until May 2013. There was an exterior wall renovation works in Cho Ping North Estate. It was carried out by the housing department. And at that time, as far as refurbishment of the exterior wall was concerned, no storage area was provided for the materials. And it so happened that we had this flat, which could be used for this purpose, and at the same time, we can minimize the nuisance to neighboring tenants. And this is a special case. So that's the special case. I'm sorry, but why didn't you give this explanation to the audit, Mr. Liu? In the process, we did provide information. But I think the audit might not have included all our information. And I'd like to share with members how we carry out our monitoring work. And in the housing department, we have a target of 44 work days for completion of refurbishment works. And on average, we could complete it within 43 days. And for TPS estates and for the subsidized housing subcommittee of the housing authority, actually, in the first half of this year, we were able to complete have a turnaround time of about 41 days on average. And we also have a three-tier monitoring mechanism. As far as the frontline staff is concerned, we have professionals and engineers. We have weekly meeting when we check the progress with our contractor, and our senior works professional will have bi-monthly contract meeting when we check the quality of refurbished flats, and where necessary, we'll also hold special meetings to review the progress of refurbishment. As for flats taking longer time for refurbishment, report has to be made on a quarterly basis to our regional estate manager. So through this system, we together with professionals, we closely monitor the refurbishment work. Chairman, I have two more questions to ask, and then move on to underoccupied flats and well-off tenants. All right, please allow me to ask these two questions first. It has to do with the same topic. Mr. Liu, can you give us a very brief paper? Now, Table 18, that seems to be a very lengthy one. Maybe I can supply supplementary information. Yes, so as to facilitate our report compilation. Back to 3.16, 17, and 19. I have two to three questions on these paragraphs. If the housing department would be kind enough to answer our questions, we can it could help us write our report. Now, some of the tenant flats were converted to domestic flats, and on-site visits were arranged, and the cost of conversion works were estimated. However, in the end of May 2013, when the audit inspected the site, it was found that refurbishment works of these 16 flats had still not been completed. Can the administration explain why these 16 flats could not be completed within the target of 44 days as set by the housing department? I'm just talking about the 16 flats. You can be succinct. In 3.17, we explained that in fact they were the 16 flats in Sharkhawk Estate. Some shop tenants upstairs were about to take these flats. However, there was a request from these tenants. They hope that the renovation work could be carried out by more phases than usual, so as to minimize the disturbance to their businesses. And it was supported by district councillors. And on their request, the works took longer than usual. But in fact, the works were completed in October, and 11 out of the 16 flats have been let. Well, yes, we understand that because works order was issued in August 2013 and it was expected to be completed by the end of September. And you tell me that now it's done. Yes, 11 has been let. And on table 19, analysis of the vacancy period of unlettable flats. 598 flats were left vacant for unknown reasons. And according to the Housing Department, in their database, they have not recorded the last tenancy termination date. So what is meant by the termination date of the last tenancy of these flats not available in the DTMS? It should be made available for access. So is there any guidelines on how the records are to be made? Now, ironically, 3.32, it mentions something about the DTMS and the tenancy information being maintained in the DTMS. So can you give me an answer? Table 19, I think on the last occasion, we also asked a question on it. So please give us a more detailed answer, Mr. Liu. Mr. Wong just now asked about the 598 flats and asked why we could not provide the vacancy period for these flats. When the audit checked our system, now the computer system, once the flats are no longer vacant, we could not retrieve the information about a vacancy period before. And out of the 598 flats, many of the flats are originally HSC Type 1 flats, pending conversion. For other flats, it's easier for us to retrieve information, whereas for the HSC Type 1 flats and C1P flats, we had some difficulties in retrieving the relevant information in the computer system, and we did explain this situation to the audit. All right, next, Mr. Ng Leung Sing, followed by Mr. Alan Leung. Mr. Ng Leung Sing. Thank you, Chairman. Now, I'd like to speak on 3.26 on the well-off tenants' policies. It's a matter of principle. From the perspective of value for money, we agree that low-income families should receive subsidy to ensure rational allocation of limited public housing resources. And here it says, the HA encourages PRH households who have benefited from a steady improvement in their income and assets to return their PRH flats to the HA for reallocation to families that are more in need of PRH flats. I believe some questions in this area have been asked. Now, this is the general principle, and according to the audit's recommendation in 3.40, he recommends that the well-off tenant policy be fine-tuned, and I don't think it's just a matter of fine-tuned. It should, in fact, be enhanced. So my question is on assets. Now, I'm not picking on anyone, but after 1996, after implementation of the policy in 1996, the so-called two pillars, that's income and assets respectively. Let me check the page number. Page 71, 4.3, page 82 in the English version. Assets include land, landed properties, vehicles, taxi, public light bus licenses, investments, business undertakings, etc. So, I don't know if your approach is scientific-based, whether a scientific approach is taken on investigating the net value of assets, such that flat reallocation can be done in a timely manner to families that are more in need of the flats. I don't know if you have a systematic approach. Now, on income and assets vetting, I'll defer to Mr. Liu in a moment. But in fact, indeed, we take a two-pillar approach. We look at the income and also the assets and see whether the income has exceeded the asset limit by 84 times. And in the past, we heard views from the LTHS steering committee and whether the two-pillar approach should be reviewed. And we have undertaken to review the situation. It's also contained in the LTHS paper. So I'll defer to Mr. Liu to speak on assets. Yes, under the well-off tenants policies, we take a two-pronged approach on or it's two-pillar based. Now, for a PRH tenant has lived there for 10 years, 2 years after he has been paying double rent as a well-off tenant, he will then be required to make a biennial report of the assets and insets. Around 3,500 tenants per year are required to declare their assets, and our central team colleagues takes up 100% of these cases in following up the situation, because we take a more stringent approach, because flat can be repossessed. And according to 4.3 in the audit report B, it sets out the types of assets: land, landed properties, vehicles, taxi, public light bus licenses, etc. So in the declaration form, this information is contained, so applicant understands what to declare. And apart from having interviews with them, we will also check with the land registry, the transport department, and banks to ensure that the declaration does not contain omission. Mr. Mlong Seng? Let's say monthly income, so and so, and assets can be accumulated very quickly unless you encourage the person to squander away the money. He might be buying a gold watch, etc., so that he can squander money away. But you take a two-pillar approach, so no assets are accumulated. What about making donations? I may donate money to an organization or for a purpose on which I have the power to instruct what to do with the money. So that's a blatant misuse of public money. And yet you say that this is already the most scientific approach in resolving the problem. Are there any such cases? And if you receive such complaints, what is the handling mechanism to address the problem? Mr. Liu, As far as the policy is concerned, as a PRH tenant, we tell them clearly under what circumstances they are required to turn over for the flat or pay double rent. And for example, in the case mentioned by Mr. Ng, if somebody transfers his money or deposit to the family member, there is difficulty in our investigation. The bank might tell us that there is no asset, and if the person doesn't honestly declare that money has been transferred to his son last week, for example. However, that person has to bear a risk if he transfers money to another person. The person might be holding his money on trust, but there is a risk whether he can get the money back. This inspection is carried out, or declaration is made once every 2 years. I can't say that there are no such cases, but as far as our work is concerned, we don't think there are too many such cases. Mr. Prescott?
Declaration is only one part of our supervision of our tenants. We actually do investigate on the basis of complaints, on the basis of information that we receive from other sources, and we also investigate for things like false declarations and what have you. And where we come across those cases, and it's the sort of case that the Honourable Member is talking about, we will take prosecution action. Mm. What we're talking about here is the general yes. approach to the reporting system, but there is another system above that.
Thank you. Leung Sing.
Mr. Leung Sing.
But one of my key points was after transfer of assets, there's still a connection and there's still the right to use it. So with that kind of investigation, when you receive such cases, would there be a file opened? And then you can see that perhaps after your investigation, the donated or transferred assets would not then be used by those who've transferred the assets. Well, yes, there is such a mechanism for every complaint case. We have a procedure to follow in handling the complaint. And when estate officers have completed the case, the case will go to the central team, and the dedicated central professional team will again look at the case. We'll make sure that all complaint cases are dealt with properly. So you mean afterwards, the relevant vetting party could still ask for the information, right? The information is kept. For personal particulars, no, they cannot be provided. But let's say someone complains about another household. We've done the investigation whether the complaint is substantiated or not. We will not inform the complainant of the outcome. We will just write a reply to the complainant to say that we have received your complaint. We will deal with it in accordance with the established procedure, because there is privacy involved, so we are not going to tell the complainant the outcome of the investigation. We'll just tell them we follow a mechanism in handling the case. And this mechanism, is there just one level of investigation, or how many levels of vetting are there? Well, as I said, for the first round of investigation is done by the estate office, and the investigation findings would be submitted to the senior manager and the manager of the central investigation team for vetting. Well, I know there are a lot of reports, when there was the tsunami, by accident it was found that someone was using abusing public housing resources. And I believe the abuse of public rental public housing resources is still rather common, because now the rent is $64.42 per square meter, so it's about $6.40 for a square foot. you compare it to subdivided flats, it's a far cry from the market level. So there is a huge incentive, and this is in para 3.38. And so it's difficult to get people to vacate their flats. Now, just now, some colleagues mentioned this. How do we move this PRH well-off tenants to HOS so they'll give up their PRH flats? Now, these days, it's no longer case that people actually live in HOS flats. They treat HOS flats as an investment. They may sell the flats after paying the premium. So we wouldn't know how many HOS flats we need to build. Actually, I never agree that we should stop producing HOS flats, because without this mobility ladder, there's no way we could move PRH tenants from PRH units to HOS flats. And so PRH tenants will hold on to their units even if they have to pay double rent. So shouldn't you keep up with the developments in the community? So you make sure that people buy HOS as accommodation. Now, I'm not going to speak on the decision of the previous government, but for this term of the government, HOS is part of the public housing policy. It's hoped that when HOS flats are completed, then PRH tenants could buy HOS flats using the green forms. But of course, when they have bought HOS flats, they will vacate the PRH flats and there will be mobility or turnaround of PRH flats. 3.51 and 3.52, under occupation households. It started in 2007. It's good that we have this development. Now, of course, if the household size is shrunken and they have more space than they're entitled to, they should give up such space. It's good. 3.52 here. The audit noted that among the 1,765 most serious MS cases, 749, or as much as 43%, had remained outstanding for 2 years or more. So there are some 1,700 MS cases, but then the efficiency in dealing with these cases is so low. So from the point of view of value for money, how can you ensure you have enough capacity to deal with these cases? What about the second most serious cases? Do you have information on that as well? Because you have to keep improving efficiency so that we can make the most of public housing resources. Let me give an answer, and then Mr. Liu could give you more details. Now, we have standards for under occupation. It's mentioned in the audit report. We believe our standards are reasonable. But then there are some households not listed as priority households because they have elderly persons or persons with disabilities in the family. Because that's the policy of the housing authority, we need to be compassionate as well. So these are not priority cases. But then for other EO households, they to be moved to smaller units, and we try to offer them units in the same estate or even find them new units. Sometimes there is need for estate staff to talk to households about the arrangement. So it will take some time, but it shouldn't be too long. Mr. Liu? 3.52, the 1,000, or rather the 749 outstanding cases for 2 years or more. Is as the secretary explained. Before the 1st of October, the EO policy was to offer to make four housing offers. So for each offer, there would be 3 months to 6 months for seeing through the offer. But there could be special cases if reasons are given. For example, the household told us the spouse has just passed away. Please don't ask me to move so soon, because I'm still in bereavement. So we try to be compassionate. while we observe the rules and regulations. And it's a fact that it's also our undertaking that we will offer suitable units in the same estate and the same district. And there are cases where we were unable to offer suitable units. That's why the handling time would be longer. But if I could give you some figures. In the past 6 years, 2007, for the most serious cases, there were 4,400. In the past 6 years, there were 2,900 new cases. In other words, there were 7,300 cases in total. But after we introduced a new policy, that is, we offer them new units to encourage people to move, we also offer a removal allowance, and then we have the cooperation of households. And we are pleased to see that in the past 6 years, we've dealt with 5,600 cases. So from 7,300 MS cases, by June 2013, it's come down to 1,765 cases. Of course, our work is not completed, because there will still be new cases coming up, but we will try to speed up processing of such cases while being compassionate and while complying with the regulations. 4.17. The high percentage of false declaration. And then, so it suggested that you should do more in-depth checking by the PHRM. You should consider increasing the sample size. Now, is it the case that the false declaration rate remains on the high side? Have you increased your manpower to deal with such checking so as to reduce such cases? Mr. Liu, we agree at the application stage we check randomly 300 cases, perhaps as on the low side, especially in the initial application stage, there's a high rate of false declaration. So we've done some internal review and we agreed to increase the number of sample check cases. Of course, we understand it is one of our priority tasks to ensure to optimize the use of public housing resources. That's why we have transfer 30 experienced estate officers to the central team. So this year, instead of 5,000 cases, we'll be able to check as 10,000 cases. Mr. Gary Chen. Table 33, page 107 in the English version. False declaration cases related to waiting list applicants. Mr. Liu said just now that we're deploying more manpower to the team working on false declarations. You'll be doing more random checks. Now, as many colleagues pointed out, public housing resources are invaluable. But if you look at table 33, you can see that the audit is able to work out a trend. In the past 5 years, for cases referred to prosecution section, a total of 1,485 cases. But there are only 368 cases prosecuted because there's enough evidence. As for cases without enough evidence, 1,111 cases. So only a quarter of the cases could be prosecuted. And in 2008, actually, the prosecution rate was close to 50%. But by 2012 to 13, the prosecution rate dropped to just 15%. Why has it dropped to such a low level? Since you have deployed more people now to deal with false declarations. Then when these cases actually refer to the prosecution section, and a decision is made whether to take up prosecution, it seems that the prosecution rate is very low now. It's because whenever people think this is a suspected case, or I don't care, I'll just pass it to the prosecution section, I'll leave it to the section to see whether there's a case. Or is it a case that the prosecution section will study each and every case very carefully? It takes a stringent approach. That's why the prosecution rate is so low. So what is the reason? Kitty. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. About the changes in the prosecution rate. Sorry, speaker's not coming through. Yes. Let me start again. When the draft of the report was given to us, we already gave a reason. We prepared a report for the audit. There are three reasons, actually. One was in 2010, the Department of Justice issued a guideline. That is, prosecution must not lead or steer investigation. Now, very often the prosecution section will help design questions for the investigation colleagues. That is, if they are to ask questions, how questions should be put. But that is, when they take caution statements, they can refer to our questions. But after this guidelines issue, we can no longer help with designing such questions, and that may affect the prosecution rate. And then the second reason is that there have been changes in the types of false declarations, and that's added to the difficulties in prosecution. For example, in 2008-09, more than half of the cases had to do with income and property ownership. And it's relatively easy to prove the falsity of information. For example, you just need to obtain an certificate from the employer, or we just need to do a land search. So it's relatively easy to prove such cases. But then in recent years, people have different types of assets, and maybe in insurance policies, trust funds, and so on. So when it comes to proving the falsity of information, has become more difficult. The third reason it's been difficult to identify witnesses, and there are fewer self-admission cases too. So these are the primary reasons why the quality of evidence has gone down. And when we took our prosecutions, we have to follow the prosecutions, the code of prosecutions, and the code is issued by the Department of Justice. There are two standards to achieve. First, the sufficiency of evidence. That is, the criminal elements have to be there, and this evidence has to be admissible in court. And the second standard is that on the basis of the evidence, we could deduce a reasonably chance of success, a reasonable chance of success in prosecution. So our colleagues have to make sure these two elements are met, and our colleagues have to consider each and every case. It's not we certainly have not a target to say when so many cases are referred to us, we make sure there is prosecution in so many cases. No, definitely we won't do that.
Mr. Gary Chan, of course, prosecution action will be taken when there is reasonable suspicion. And if a decision is made, 90% of the cases will end in the conviction. And this shows that you have made a good decision. But there are about 75% of the cases in which there is insufficient evidence to warrant prosecution, but still there is suspicion. Out of the 75%, will there be any follow-up work taken since there is a suspicion? Perhaps, maybe for the time being, there is not enough evidence to warrant prosecution. But during a review or during allocation or a flat housing offer, that something will be done. Is there a follow-up mechanism to look into cases in which prosecution action is not yet taken? Mr. Liu, whether there will be prosecution, as mentioned previously, there is a very high threshold. Both elements will have to be met before the case is taken to the court. But when it comes to PRH unit management, well, for cases that does not warrant prosecution, say if double rent has to be paid, we will chase for the double rent outstanding. And if it's a false declaration, although we don't have sufficient evidence to take the case to the court, we can still terminate the tenancy and recover the unit. So the follow-up work is in tandem with the prosecution action. There are different considerations when it comes to prosecution, but we will not wait for the court decision before we take action. We will just deal with the cases based on the information we have. Mr. Chen, table 33. Out of the 1,000 odd cases, only 6 of them, the figure is quite low, that the time bar has elapsed, so no prosecution action was taken. And in this year, there are 2 cases for which the time bar has exceeded. The audit suggests that the housing department should, within 2 months, refer relevant documents and information to the prosecution section so that these cases will be dealt with in a timely manner. But I don't see any positive response from the department in this regard. What is the stance to the suggestion of the audit? When we discover the case, it's already beyond the time bar. That may be the result. So for those 2 cases, is that the case? Yes. Well, when we discover the case, it's already beyond the time bar from the time when the false declaration was made. We have improved our working guideline. We will reduce the number of cases of late referral. What about the suggestion of the audit to refer documents within 2 months? Will you do that? Can you give us an undertaking? This will be the direction that we are taking. Well, what about the undertaking? As far as practicable, as soon as we have discovered the case, of course, there are certain steps to be taken by the estate officers. We will follow the guideline and refer the case to the prosecution unit, the section. Mr. Chen, I don't have any follow-up. In the first round, we still have Alan. After that, we will take a break of 10 minutes. Is that okay? Mr. Leung, I'd like to follow up on the well-off tenant policy. My understanding is that if the income of the tenant two times or three times of the income limit, you will have to pay 1.5 times of the rent. If it's 3 times of the income limit, double the rent. Two times of the net rent. And if you pay 2 times the net rental, then in 2 years' time, you will have to declare your assets. When it reaches 84 times of the income limit or the asset limit, you will have to surrender the flat. If you look at 3.36 and 3.37 and compare it with table 20, you will see that the enforcement itself causes concern. Of course, when it comes to the if it's an average, we cannot fully rely on it. But in note 13, on page 64, it says that as at 31st of March 2013, a PRH household comprised 2.85 persons on average. So less than 3 persons. Note 14, it says that the majority of PRH households, actually 97%, comprised not more than 5 persons. So the picture painted by table 20, that is 116,397. Now you see that figure, 116,397. Falls between 25,000 and 100,000 when it comes to household income. And in 3.37, it pointed out that for the 116,397, they have a household income of 25,000 or more, which was close to the income limit of a 5P household. So about 20,000 households. Well, it now says 18,109. Pays 1.5 times 23,021 pays a double. So compared to the over 700,000 PRH tenants, the percentage is rather low. If we compare one average with another, let's look at table 20. There are well-off tenants that are not discovered, so they are not paying 1.5 or 2 times of the net rental. Perhaps the director may tell me that for 3.36 and 3.37, for these two paragraphs, they are the average. So you can't tell that actually there are a number, this many households that are making a household income of that close to a 5-person household income limit. But there is a huge gap, a big discrepancy here. Is it from the picture painted by the audit, is it the case that there are so many people who have remain undiscovered and they are well-off tenants? Of course, the director is responsible for operation or enforcement as well. So if we look at the information from 3.37 and table 20, my conclusion is that the implementation of the well-off tenancy results in too many undiscovered cases. So what is the problem? I'd like to know. Secretary, who's to take the question? Mr. I'd like to ask a member to turn to Annex 3, Appendix D. That is the supplementary information we supplied. So PA 331 / 1314. You'll find on the table. Is Annex C, Appendix D. For a 3P household, if the income is between 36,621 to just over 54,000. They will have to pay 1.5 times the rental. They will have to make over 54,130 before they pay double the rent. If you refer to Table 20 of the PAC report on page 65 of the English version, if you draw the line there at 40,000 to 59,000 and that onwards, there are about 20 or 21,000 households making over 40,000 in their household income. And if you look at the figure provided by us, that is paragraph 3.36, 18,109 households were paying 1.5 times the rent and 2,321 paying double the rent. So the figures are consistent. Let me have some time to digest the information. Perhaps Mr. Liu will supplement. Please refer to Appendix D. The information shows that for a 3P family, if they make less than $36,000, they don't have to pay double the rent. If they make between $36,000 and $54,000, they have to pay additional rent. So for $36,621, it is the double or triple the amount of the income limit. Yes, and that I understand. Let's draw a line here, and if we look at Table 20 of the PAC report, there is an analysis saying that setting up the distribution of household income of the 700,000 households. If you draw a line at 40,000 to 59,000 and up, so there are about, for the group between 40,000 and 59,000, 19,000 households, 60,000 to 79,000, about 2,000 households. And they will have to pay additional rent. If you add 19,684 with 2,443, 702 and 473, I think there are about 22,000 households. They make over 40,000. And from Table 20, it shows that about 22,000 households making more than 40,000 in their household income. And the information we supply is that there are about 21,000 households paying additional rent. This proves that what we have say in Appendix D. How did you come up with a 21,000 household? Paragraph 3.36 in the PAC report, it says that among them, 20,445. For the 20,445, and this cannot be glimpsed from Appendix D. You will have to look at a 3P household, so if you have to make more than 36,000. Well, there are more households with a 3P than other sizes. So on average, 2.8 persons in a household. So we will use the figure of Note 13. Yes, then I understand. But what I don't understand is that for the 21,000, you talk about giving the figure. Where? Paragraph 3.36, the figure reported to the audit is close to 21,000. Then I understand. If you compare the two figures, there is a very small difference. I'd like to ask the audit, is that your understanding? Because from what I see in paragraph 3.37, it says that there should, on the face of it, be more well-off tenants. The audit. Perhaps I will defer to the Assistant Commissioner or Deputy Commissioner. Table 20. We arrive at the conclusion in 3.37. From our analysis, we found that for a lot of the households, they have seen some improvement in the financial situation in the past few years. The median is more or less as other households, but I agree with Mr. Liu. Details of the policy are very complicated. Say, for example, declaration after 10 years and then further vetting once every 2 years. And if we take a snapshot, it may not reflect the actual number of households paying additional rent or 2 times the rent. You only have to pay 2 times the rent if your household income exceeds 3 times of the income limit. Well, at the time when the application was made, of course, they're subject to an income limit. But their situation improves. And of course, if they make the application now, then they will be ineligible. But if you are to pay 2 times of the rent, you will have to make an household income of 3 times of the income limit. That explains the difference. And that is the point we're trying to make in 3.37. The well-off tenant policy is an incentive for well-off tenants to surrender their PRH units, say, for example, to move to an HOS flat or in private housing. And in the end, there is not enough incentive to achieve this goal. Well, now you talk about incentive, and I have a question. Whether the well-off tenancy policy is successful in that they fulfill the policy intent from the perspective of money value for money analysis, you will have to meet 2 requirements. For the $64 per square meter rent is rather low. Whether you times it by 2 or 3 is still peanuts because the base figure is so low. The secretary said that this will be reviewed under the long-term housing strategy. Do you agree that the level is set too low? That's why the policy intent, your policy objective is not met. And about the income and assets, they will have to both exceed the limit, well, say, to pay 2 times the net rent, you will have to make 3 times the income limit and 84 times of the asset limit. If the policy objective is to be met, if you already own asset 84 times of the asset, you don't really have to look at the income. Why do these two have to be met at the same time? Under the current well-off tenant policy, for a tenant to surrender the flat, they will have to reach the threshold of both income level and asset level. Of course, there is room for improvement. And in the steering committee of the LTHS, there is someone mentioned about this. Someone asked whether a well-off tenant will have to vacate the flat when only one element is met instead of 2. Mr. Leung asked about the low number or the small number. We set the level at 3 times the income limit. And there aren't so many households who will meet this criteria. And if we want more households to vacate their flats, of course we can push the level down. And back in the 1990s, when the well-off tenant policy was formulated, there was a lot of discussion, a fierce debate in the LegCo. We have to strike a balance. Why do we only ask for a vetting after 10 years? Because when they first moved in, they have already gone through the income and asset test, the means test. And we want to give incentives for PRH tenants to move out once they are better off. But of course, we have to give them some time to have their situation improve. And that's why we put in place the 1.5 times and double times of rental.
Alan, Chairman, I am not suggesting that the tenant should declare his assets even before he has lived in the flat for 10 years. But from the perspective of value for money audit, now $64.4 per square meters. We're talking about $12.8 per square feet. This is not an incentive for the tenants to move out of the flat. Well, as Secretary already said that this issue will be followed up by the LTHS Steering Committee, perhaps we should wait. But I heard the Secretary loud and clear. Back then, at the LegCo, when we had a discussion, we didn't just take the perspective of value for money when we had the discussion. Now, Chief Secretary for Administration, in the consultation paper on poverty alleviation, she agrees that public rental housing is the most effective means to alleviate poverty. For tenants living in public housing, they can accumulate assets in 10 years, and the situation is much better than tenants living in subdivided flats and cubicles in the private sector. And that is why, as the most effective poverty alleviation measure, more public rental housing should be provided. And I heard Secretary's explanation. Do you have another question? No need to queue up again. I do have another question. You're the last one in this round. My next question has to do with underoccupied flats. That's in 3.55, starting from 3.55 to 3.60. Chairman, let's look at the table. Please give me a moment. Table 21, page 57 in the Chinese version or page 68 in the English version. Table 21, maximum allocation standard, and then the UO standard, and then finally, most serious UO threshold. So, keeping this in mind, we then can turn to table 24 and 25, where we can see that the problem is quite serious. In table 24, that's an aging analysis of UO cases, and then table 25, analysis of outstanding MS, most serious cases. So, let's look at table 25 first. For those most serious UO cases, that means one person might be occupying more than 340 square feet or 34 square meters. Situations like that. Or a two-person household occupying 680 square feet. And 16 households left outstanding for 5 years or more. So 749 cases, outstanding cases in these MS cases. Can you explain the blunder? These households are regarded as MS UO cases, and yet 749 households can continue to occupied extra space for more than 2 years. Mr. Liu, as explained just now, the UO policy, before the 1st of October, we made four housing offers, And having heard the public's views and having reviewed our work in the past few years, we found that in most of the cases, three housing offers would suffice. So under the new policy, starting from the 1st of October, only three housing offers would be made. In Table 25, 749 cases had remained outstanding for 2 years or more. In particular, 16 households had remained outstanding for 5 years or more. There are special reasons for each of the 16 households. If due to social or medical reasons, they occupied extra space and we therefore would allow them. For example, the person might just have got married in the mainland and the spouse might be waiting for a one-way permit to come here for family reunion. And without the one-way permit, we can't allocate another room, so in that case, we'll wait for the one-way permit to be issued for the spouse to come to occupy the flat. There are cases like these when we know that the spouse will be coming to Hong Kong in 2 or 3 years' time. And there are also other cases in which the tenant might be mentally ill, and it might be recommended by the social welfare department. The person might not be an elderly, might not be a disabled tenant. But under such special circumstances, even though the person might not be permanently disabled, we do allow such cases to remain. But we have a monthly report where the headquarters will send the cases remaining outstanding to the regional manager, so that for the backlog of cases, the regional manager will be asked to follow up on them. And in those case files, all they contains all the documents submitted by the tenants and the reasons for the situation to remain, and as long as it's reasonable and it's not up to just to the regional manager to decide. For each of the 16 cases, the chief manager personally checked all these cases and considered appropriate for more time to be given to these UO households. I understand that before the 1st of October 2013, four housing offers would be made. Now it's just down to three housing offers, which means that the time will be shortened because you have one offer fewer, and it will be a shorter time before the UO household is required to move out. As Mr. Liu put it just now, you do have special arrangements where it's justified and on compassionate grounds. I agree. However, can we really explain all of these cases? 43% of the MS cases had remained outstanding for 2 years or more. Is it really the case that each of the 749 cases had special reasons, Mr. Liu? Most of these cases had special reasons. Of course, there are the individual cases in which we can't find a suitable flat in the same district. For example, in Sai Wan Estate, there are too few small flats, and it is the Housing Department's policy that relocation should be made within the district or within the same estate. So we need to wait for smaller units to become available in Sai Wan Estate before the tenant can be relocated. We do have the some actual difficulties in finding smaller flats. So I have another question as to whether the UO cases can help the turnover of flats for people in need. Now, in 3.53, those offers will be made and there is a lack of suitable flats for transfer within the same estate or an estate within the same DC constituency, then can the UO household apply for a flat across in another district? Can he be allowed to do that as long as it's within the DC constituency? For example, the UO household might be in Fucheng estate. If he is required to move to a smaller flat, then a smaller flat should be allocated in Cham Shui Po or in the same Fucheng estate. However, that tenant might say that he prefers to be relocated to Kun Tong because his son is living there. If it's still within the urban district, and if resources allow, we're happy to make this arrangement, including newer estates. Under this policy, we agree or we encourage this sort of thing, because for UO tenants moving to a smaller flat, he might not be comfortable with it. So we encourage them to move to another flat in, say, a new estate or another estate in the same district. That is to say, it's quite flexible. You won't force the household to move to another district, but on various reasons, if this is his choice, you will allow them. One more question. A question for the department or the for director or for secretary. If more subsidies are given to UO households, do you think it's more effective in encouraging them to move to smaller flats? The amount is in tandem with the actual circumstances, but that's not the crucial factor. The crucial factor is the UO household is not used to the new flat. Well, now the 1P household, the criterion is over 30 square meters. For frontline staff, it's quite difficult for them to deal with your households because we don't just look at figures, we look at their family circumstances. I personally have dealt with such a case. Both parents to a child unfortunately died. And in such circumstances, that household became a your household and we could not just follow the rules. Next, in the second round, Mr. Raymond Wong and Dr. Kenneth Leung. And we can have a 10-minute break now. Sorry, this session is quite long. Let's have a break. Thank you.